Við vorum áður með mann frá Massachusetts Institute of Technology í þættinum, frægum háskóla MIT, það var hann Einar Steingrímsson og nú fáum við annan MIT-mann, það Noam Chomsky. Þetta eru brot af fundi sem hann var haldinn í háskólabíói, umræðu fundi, þar sem hann var í á svona einhverri tölvu línu. Myndgæðin ekkit óskaplega góð og hljóðið ekkit óbúðslega gott heldur, en við höfum þetta líka stutt, en við heyrum þarna í þessum frægamanni sem já, ég má segja, hann sé kannski frægast í álitskjafi í heimi, en allavega maður sem við skrifa margar bækur og frægur hugsuður á sviði stjórnmála og samfélagsmála.
During this period, this essentially neoliberal period of financialization, relying on markets, mythical ideas about market efficiency and rational expectation. During this period, there have been repeated crises. There's been stagnation of real incomes for most of the population, and people have kept going by increasing debt and by asset inflation, that is, relying on bubbles. The most recent is the housing bubble, $8 trillion of fake wealth. And that's where people put their money for, say, for retirement, for college education for their children, and so on. That's all gone. As far as the productive system is concerned, in manufacturing in the United States, unemployment is at the level of the Great Depression, 1930s, and the jobs aren't coming back. I mean, not under current conditions. They're being shipped abroad and where it's cheaper, and you don't have to worry about environment and working conditions and so on. For the population, that's pretty much a disaster. I mean, it's not third world level poverty, but it's very severe. And the population is reacting with a lot of anger and fear and lashing out and seeking somebody to blame, blame illegal immigrants or whatever, along with the there's also a rise of kind of demagogic extreme right propaganda, which is pretty frightening in its character. And you can see why it appeals to people. They want an answer to what's happened to them, and they're not getting any. Many government programs which exacerbate the problem. One of the main ones now, discussed quite a lot because it became so obvious, is the government insurance policy to corporations, to financial corporations, which is called too big to fail. So, for example, if Goldman Sachs or Citigroup or Bank of America make very risky loans and investments, and hence make a lot of profit, they can pretty much ignore the fact that it all may crash, the house of cards may crash, because if it does, the government will step in because they're too big to fail and will rescue them. That's what happened, in fact, with Goldman Sachs, with AIG, Citigroup, and others, and it's not for the first time. Well, that encourages executives to take risk, short-term profit, and not worry too much about the long-term outcome. In effect, it's a system of socialization of cost and privatization of profit, which is the way a lot of the economy works, in fact. And there are other perverse incentives, like rules that permit corporate executives to pick the panels that give them their salaries. One of the reasons why corporate managerial salaries in the United States are way beyond comparable societies like Europe or Japan. It's not that the CEOs and the managers are any more efficient. It's just they have techniques to raise their own salaries, and that's not small. The big banks, which are way too big, could be broken up. After all, the government practically owned them and at one point could have instituted changes. But at this point comes the political clout of concentrated capital. Obama, for example, is pretty much a creature of the financial institutions. If you take a look at his funding in the 2008 election, it was highly concentrated in financial institutions. And the way American politics works, same elsewhere, those who essentially buy the candidate, buy the election, they expect to be paid off And they were. So Obama's steps when he came into office were, the first thing he did was select as his economic advisors the people who were, had primary responsibility for the crisis, the environmental crisis, which is huge. I mean, that's really a problem of, you know, the financial crisis is bad enough, but you can patch it up. The environmental crisis is quite different. No way of patching it up. Either we're going to take it seriously and do something about it, or else we're bequeathing a catastrophe to our grandchildren. But just to give you one instance of the consequences of that, I mean, as you're aware, the Republicans are pretty likely to take over the House and maybe the Senate, at least a good part of it. Now, there are, so an analysis of this, I think there are 48 Republican senators running for office. Of those 48, one of them thinks that humans affect global warming. Mike Castle. And he lost in the primary to a Tea Party extremist who, you know, kind of like off the spectrum. So that means 100% of the Republican candidates are science rejectors. Well, the consequences of that for legislation, for popular opinion, are pretty awful. One is a trajectory that is leading towards disaster, and that's built as deep roots in existing institutions that tried to indicate. The other is a trajectory that's trying to combat it and is increasing. It doesn't have the resources, it doesn't have the organization, of course, has its own alternative media, not the major media, but it has people. And the question is, which trajectory will dominate? And I think the fate of the species depends on that. So it's not a matter of optimism or pessimism, no point speculating about it. Rather, it's a question of commitment to make sure that the right trajectory prevails. You know, the many crises that are around and the many problems, there are two that are overwhelming because they do affect decent survival of the species. One is likely environmental catastrophe, which we've talked about. The other is what Russell and Einstein talked about in their manifesto of 1955, and that was nuclear war. That problem is still with us, and it's growing. The general hatred and skepticism and anger about institutions has extended to science as well. If you look at the attitudes towards Congress, I mean, they're abysmal, you know. A large part of the population thinks Congress should be thrown out, and people off the streets would do better. Attitudes towards government in general are the support is very low towards the political parties. The support for the Democratic Party is quite low, and interestingly, support for the Republican Party is even lower, even though they're probably going to win the next election, November. And the same generalizes to other institutions, to doctors, to scientists. Run across the board, there's just a sense in the population of anger and fear, and that they, those bad people, are doing something to us. What other explanation could there be for the fact that the way our lives are falling apart? Well, that's a dangerous mix, and science falls into it. Why should we believe the scientists? Who are they? Just a bunch of elitists from, Harvard.